Assalamu alaikum and a very good day to all of you. Greetings from Daffodil International University, Bangladesh. Ladies and gentlemen, respected speakers, dear audience, this is Syed Rayhanul Islam, Senior Assistant Director of International Affairs, Daffodil International University. Would like to welcome you all to the webinar on non-tariff measures in trade between Bangladesh and India, hosted by Enterprise Competitiveness Institute, ECI, DIU, in collaboration with International Affairs of Daffodil International University, Bangladesh. According to the trade data, Bangladesh imports the highest number of goods from India after China, and Bangladesh trade volume to India should be more compared to the existing volume. One of the important causes of this phenomena is non-tariff measures, NTM, which have become common nowadays. NTMs are applied as manner that became more trade restrictive and hinders trade. So today, to talk about this issue, I would like to introduce all the speakers of today's webinar who have joined us today, managing their busy schedule from Bangladesh and India. Let us introduce the speakers of today's webinar. We have with us Dr. Sugant, Dean, School of Management and School of Economics and Commerce, CMR University, India, which is one of our partner universities from India. We have also with us Mr. MD Mamunur Rashid Askari, Deputy Chief of International Cooperation Division, Bangladesh, Trade and Tariff Commission, Bangladesh. At the same time, we also have with us Dr. Rajnish Clare, Associate Director, Planning and Monitoring, and Head, Department of Economics and Adams University, Kolkata, India, which is also our another partner from India. Last but not the least, also with us, Mr. MD Nafiz Imtiaz Islam, Deputy Director, Enterprise Competitiveness Institute, ECI of Daffodil International University. Hello, everyone, sir. We welcome you all today to this webinar. To start our today's session, let me welcome Dr. R. Sugant, Dean, School of Management and School of Economics and Commerce, CMR University, Bangalore, India, for his valuable speech and sharing his note for the webinar. Sir, the floor is yours. Sir, your microphone, please.
Thank you, Mr. Syed Rayhan Ul Islam. In fact, I deem it a pleasure and privilege to be here on this stage, partnering with the Daffodil International University. So thanks to you, and thanks to Mr. Nafiz Imtiaz Islam, Deputy Director of the Research Center of Daffodil International University. It's a great day. Yes, I think we are going through tough times, but obviously we look at future with optimism. And in this context, it'll be nice to share what exactly we think should be the way forward for the India and Bangladesh trade. So given that, let me just allow me to share my PPT. Yeah. So briefly, this panel discussion, I'm happy to be participating in this webinar and panel discussion, where we are discussing with people from Bangladesh who are there in the thick of things, not only from the university, but also from the trade side. And of course, we have my fellow colleague from Adams University in Kolkata also. So briefly, we will look at the India-Bangladesh trade and what are the different non-tariff measures and way forward is what I thought we will share in this limited time. And then of course, as we go along, we will take the questions and then we will see how we can answer them. See, India and Bangladesh are natural partners, right? Our relationship goes back many, many years. And of course, we want to strengthen it as we go along. In fact, when our Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, when he decided to go abroad for the first time after the pandemic, the country he chose to visit was Bangladesh. So obviously to participate in the 50th Independence Day celebration and the centenary celebration of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, who was the father of Bangladesh, right? So I think, I mean, the relationship is something, I mean, which has to get stronger. And it has been growing stronger. In fact, as far as South Asia is concerned, Bangladesh is the largest trading partner for India. It has been increasing all the way till 2018-19, if you look at it. I mean, almost about, it has reached about $10 billion is a trade with Bangladesh. And of course, the subsequent 2 years, I mean, there is some dip, maybe because of pandemic partly. And of course, I think, I mean, going forward, I'm sure that this dip will again increase. It'll get into a much more growth trajectory is what we are hoping for, because it is there is a fair amount of decent relationship between the two leaders of both the countries. And one thing which was, or maybe a little bit cause for disturbance from the Bangladesh side, if you look at it, so this data represents the export from the Indian side, if you look at it, how it has been increasing. But of course, the imports from Bangladesh has been fairly less, which means that in terms of the trade deficit, it is skewed heavily in favor of India. So I'm sure that, I mean, we would also like to look at more imports coming from Bangladesh. So as we see here, maybe in 2021, if you look at the imports into Bangladesh, is about 6.8 billion, whereas the exports from Bangladesh to India is just about 800 million. So obviously, I think, I mean, there is a huge way to catch up, and there are opportunities to catch up in this particular area. Now, all having said that, if you look at, yes, I mean, for India, it is always good because it has become the, I mean, fifth top export destination for India, other than maybe the destinations like US, China, UAE and things like that. I mean, in fact, today Bangladesh is the fifth largest top export destination. But in terms of import, yes, I think, I mean, we are much more in the lower end. We would definitely look at importing more from Bangladesh. I am sure that there are a lot of initiatives which the government has taken. It need not only be the product export, it can even be the services import also. Can happen. So as of now, if you look at it, the major imports from Bangladesh are primarily apparels and clothing. And this is where I think, I mean, the crux of the problem also may be lying, because on the one hand, I mean, India also is a large garment exporting country, and of course Bangladesh is way beyond India. I mean, they are one of the largest garment exporter in the world. And given that, I think, I mean, maybe we need to identify some more products, either maybe agri related or maybe manufacturing related, what we can import from Bangladesh, and they, that could be the way forward, what we should be looking for. Now, having said that, Bangladesh is India's biggest development partner as well. So India has been working very closely with Bangladesh, extending lines of credit for developing the infrastructure. And of course, I think, I mean, cooperation in the power sector is another area where we have been working. And of course, I mean, fighting COVID is obviously another area where we are working. In fact, Bangladesh is one of the largest recipients of vaccines from India. And the whole lot of other things like infrastructure, the inland transportation. So there are various other things I'm sure that both the countries can work together and grow the relationship further. Now, the challenges in exporting to India are many. The high tariffs is one of that. We have been constantly reducing the tariff, but somewhere possibly in the past 5 years, if you look at it, maybe I think, I mean, we have again started looking more of inward with Atmanirbhar and the self-reliant India and the Make in India and things like that. Again, we are getting into more of a high tariff. I mean, this phenomenon is happening across the globe also as the countries get more of a nationalistic. So today, if you look at it, our tariffs are on an average, it has become about 50%. From somewhere around 20 to 30%, the tariffs have become about 50%. And of course, there are other protectionist policies which are protecting the country. The price sensitivity, local content requirement, regulatory changes and protection of IP. I mean, these are some of the broader challenges, I mean, which we are facing. Now, specifically, if you look at it, there are quite a number of non-tariff measures are also there, which the custom surcharges or the registration requirement for importers and a whole lot of sanitary and phytosanitary measures and the technical barriers to trade. And please remember, I mean, in fact, as Bangladesh complains about the non-tariff measures which are being implemented by India, India also is keeping on complaining about other countries. India complains about the US, India complains about the European Union. In fact, I mean, there are various barriers which are faced by Indian agri exporters to Europe, Indian agri exporters to China. So it is, I mean, if you look at non-tariff measures are not a unique Indian phenomenon, but it is obviously it is a global phenomenon. In fact, I mean, just about a week back, China has rejected a whole large consignment of Indian fish export, saying that, I mean, there were traces of some COVID dead virus traces. So now I think, I mean, this is something which is very difficult to eliminate because it's a dead virus is what you're talking about. So how did it come? I mean, how has it come? So it is like, I mean, they talked about some residual DNA from COVID dead virus, and because of that, it was rejected. So now with these kind of things, the sanitary and phytosanitary measures, India is also facing problem from European Union and from China and from US as well. And some of that, I mean, it looks a whole lot illogical also. The same way the technical barriers to trade also. India has its own Bureau of Indian Standards, which is validating it, and the safety standards are there. But still, when if you are exporting something to US, US insists that, I mean, that has to be approved by the US safety standard rather than only the Indian Spices Board or the Indian safety standard. So, I mean, what I'm trying to highlight here is the non-tariff measures are something which are existing across the globe. It is not only by India or it is not only by developing countries, but even by developed countries as well. Now, given that, but there are certain India-specific issues also, which may be unique to India. So one of the major things is a complex legal framework. Unlike, I think, I mean, in other countries, if you look at it, maybe there can be a single window repository wherein you'll be able to look at all the laws or orders or the rules and regulations and things like that. Whereas if you look at it in India, in fact, I mean, this is the report by UN Conference for Trade and Development, where they have identified that in India, if you look at it, the total number of institutions which are issuing the non-tariff measures related regulations are about 38. And that is where the problem comes. So it is not that non-tariff measures alone. One is the lack of transparency in non-tariff measure and the number of agencies which are involved in issuing these non-tariff measures. If you look at it, possibly, I mean, there are a whole lot of ministries are involved in that. But of course, I think, I mean, the silver lining is possibly, yes, there are about 17 ministries are involved in issuing the regulations related to non-tariff measures. But if you look at it, only the top four, they contribute about 87% of the non-tariff measures. So which means that, I mean, somebody who is exporting into India, they need not look at the whole lot of, I mean, 17 ministries which are issuing, which means that, I mean, instead of looking at 17, you need to look at only the top four. The Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, and Ministry of Commerce and Industry, and of course BIS, the Bureau of Indian Standards. So together, collectively, if you look at it, about 87% of the non-tariff measures are issued only by these four ministries. The same way, I mean, if you look at the various non-tariff measures also, the predominant non-tariff measures are only related to sanitary and phytosanitary measures and the technical barriers to trade. So, the technical barriers to trade can be, I mean, as we look at it, it can be the certification requirement, it can be the packaging requirement, it can be the labeling requirement, and so on and so forth. Is something, I mean, which we are looking at. So those are the primary measures. I mean, in fact, it is not that the pre-shipment inspection or the trade protective or the finance measures and all these things, it doesn't really, I mean, contribute to much. Primarily, these are related to only the sanitary and phytosanitary measures and the technical barriers to trade alone. So this takes care of, again, about 86% of the total non-tariff measures. So you know where exactly the problem lies. So an organization which is exporting to India, they need to look at only certain specific measures to get over this problem. And way forward, yes. I think, I mean, if you look at it, there are a lot of relationship. In fact, India-Bangladesh CEO forum has been launched in December 2020, wherein you will look at a lot of, policy level issues are getting discussed. The same way the India-Bangladesh textile industry forum was held in February 2020, where we can look at a lot more collaboration and cooperation in those sector. And there are a lot of, in fact, in the recent the meeting between the Prime Minister of India and the Prime Minister of Bangladesh, if you look at it, I mean, they have also decided to eliminate certain non-tariff measures. Plus, of course, I mean, that anti-dumping duty on jute products and things like that. So these were specifically identified for the removing. So I'm sure that, I mean, as the way forward, these issues will get eliminated and we can look forward to higher trade level and more imports from Bangladesh into India as well. So that's all, I mean, I wanted to share. So thank you very much and thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Thank you so much, Dr. R. Sugan, sir, for your very constructive note on this topic and sharing all the data and the findings you have shared with our audience. So at this moment, let me welcome and let me request Mr. M.D. Mamunur Rashid Askari, Deputy Chief of International Cooperation Division, Bangladesh, Trade and Tariff Commission, Bangladesh, to share his views and shed light on NTM issues that Bangladesh has been facing while taking part in trade with India. Sir, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I'd like to share my presentation. Can you see my slide?
Not yet, sir. We are, yeah, it's coming. Yeah, we can see your screen.
Okay, then I will start. Thank you, everyone.
Please.
So first, this is Mamun Askari. I'm a deputy chief from Bangladesh Trade and Tariff Commission. I would like to welcome you all. I would like to go a little bit about the background of NTMs. First, I'd like to start from saying that multinational trade negotiations substantially reduces customs tariff rates. This reduction is a result of the 8th round of negotiations under GATT and different regional trade agreements like PTA, FTA, and Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement. So from that point of view, as tariff in agriculture and non-agriculture product reduces substantially over the years, so here comes the rise of non-tariff measures, which are recently more than ever before. So what basically NTMs are? It's basically all policy measures other than tariffs. It has some price and quantity effect. So NTM, we cannot claim that NTMs are inherently good or bad. It depends on how we use NTMs. That's the important factor here I want to share with you. So it has some both legitimate and necessary purposes, and it sometimes it may have adverse impact on trade due to is specific discriminatory and protectionist instruments. Here lies the real problem. If we use NTMs as discriminatory and protectionist instrument, then it would be treated as non-trade barriers. So it trade cost lies here. One of the estimates I would like to share with you, the more than double that ordinary customs of trade tariffs. So what are the categories of NTMs that we usually deal with? So broadly, it has three categories. One is import status, another is export status, and another is third one is at domestic level. At import status, one country can impose import quota, import prohibitions, and export status is export tax, export subsidies. And at domestic level, domestic legislation covering health, technical product, etc. So these classifications are classified by different organizations differently, but most significantly, we frequently use classification of NTMs in the UNCTAD through trade analysis information system. This is very important. So NTMs coverage in the WTO. Actually, WTO covers the main aspects of NTMs, like in different agreements and different clauses, like Article 7 of Customs Valuation Agreement, trade technical barriers to trade and SPS agreement. These are two significant WTO agreement that addresses the issue of NTMs. Then others are rules on import licensing procedure, rules of origin, peace inspection, trade-related investment measures, state trading enterprises, trade remedies like anti-dumping, countervailing, and safeguard. So here is I want to share with you one statistics. As Dr. Sugant was mentioning, there are different types of NTMs, but one statistics from WTO ITIP shows that 64,858 NTMs notified at the WTO since 1995 to December 2018. Out of this huge amount, 89% covered under SPS and TBT. Of them, SPS 37% and TBT 52%. This is very significant information. So I want to, it has already been covered. I want to just mention that both, if you look at the bilateral trade agreement, the Bangladesh export mainly dominated by RMC and textile sector, and others, some other sectors like agriculture products, frozen food, jute and jute goods, leather goods, and major import from India, cotton, rice, motorcycles, motor vehicles, etc. And if you look at the export-import statistics, then we will find that both countries are, both export and import, bilateral export and import are increasing, but the export from Bangladesh to India is not at satisfactory level, because India, Bangladesh is getting duty-free preferences almost all the products in India, but still our export is not increasing that much level. So that's our concern. So I would like to shed some lights on sectoral NTMs imposed by India. So I have found this from World Integrated Trade Solution with statistics. So it shows that India affected products 2087, and of them, textiles and clothing, chemicals, vegetables, food products, metals, etc. Covers higher number of NTMs, and I also shows the NTMs affected trade, which is used. So if we summarize the NTMs imposed by India, we can find that mostly certification requirement issues is bigger in number. It is 1,266. And there are some other measures imposed by India, labeling requirements, as was mentioning Professor, tolerance limits for residues and registration requirements. These are the some measures imposed by India. So I'd like to mention one statistics that what India is imposing. So this is our trends statistics. Sorry. Export related measures total 53 Bangladesh is facing in India during recent times. It is up to July. So, and sanitary phytosanitary measures is the largest in number, 46. So we had a study, Bangladesh State Trade Commission in 2017-18 fiscal year. So we found that agro sector was facing higher non-tariff measures in India. And because it's actually depends on the study area and our experience and many other things, stakeholders and concern. So basically, I would like to share with you one bigger studies conducted by SASEC. So if we look at the bilateral debt, we can assume that the NTMs are a major impediment of Bangladesh export to India. Because we cannot find an exhaustive list, because it is difficult to prepare, as they are very they vary from consignment to consignment, and most NTMs are non-transparent and hence are difficult to identify. So in that study, it was found that a total number of 127 potential Bangladeshi exports which face NTMs in India, of them chemicals 21 items under AC 61 and 28 items under Chapter 62 face NTM in India. So Bangladeshi exporters do not find this what TBC, TB technical base to terrorist measures. Bangladeshi exporter does not find TBT measures at trade restrictive. So here is a point. We can analyze that we have found some technical barriers to trade or SPS measures, but that's not creating any trouble to the exporter. So that cannot be treated as non-tariff barriers. This is my point. But difficulty to undergo various tests to obtain certification from these contaminants is actually the exporter's face. NTMs faced by Bangladesh in India. I have tried to show some practical examples like anti-dumping duties in jute goods, hydrogen peroxide, fishing net, clear float glass. Some of the anti-dumping registration still is ongoing. So technical, we have technical standards related NTM, the technical regulation related NTMs in India. Like I would like to specify one example: ASOFI test and construction of fabric test for garments is mandatory garments export to India. And another NTM is banking difficulties in northern eastern India. I would not go details because I have limited time. So another is declaring soap as cosmetics. This is because of only through limited borders. This kind of problem India also face in Bangladesh. So I'd like to share in the same study, the NTMs faced by India in Bangladesh. They also face 180 potential NTMs in 108 products using a 6-digit level. So Bangladesh applies 7 SPS and 3 TBT measures on that product. So India also faced procedural obstacles in obtaining import licensing certificate, challenges related to trade infrastructure, labeling related obstacles, language related obstacles. Sometimes Bangladesh, this is a both countries' problem. The country may impose like labeling should be in Bengali language or labeling should be in Hindi language. So that create barriers to exporter. And also is unaligned food safety regulations, Bangladesh, because both countries' food safety regulations are not similar. So this also creates NTMs in both countries. So what are the key forwards? NTMs impose huge cost on import exporters, particularly from developing countries. This is true. Every country has some NTMs. This is legitimate according to WTO, one country can. But the question is, from WTO perspective, I can say that the, whether the measures is necessary. This is the important question. And next question is there any scientific evidence of that claim? So these two issues should be properly maintained before we imposing any kind of NTMs. They should be keep in mind. Proper and timely information on the NTMs is a major issue because we don't have sufficient information. So that is why we need to collect data from the stakeholder level so that we can address this issue to Indian counterpart. Inadequate information delays the export procedure, which increases the cost. And development and updating NTMs database. This is very crucial. India has tried, India and Bangladesh, has, both countries have tried to show some information on their national trade portal. I check this trade portal, very important, but my point of view is that this trade portal should be more comprehensive and more analyzed data should be preserved there so that an exporter can easily understand those kind of analysis. Enterprise level survey towards finding specific information on export impediments is crucial to collect the primary data from primary level. Extensive training program because is a different level is crucial because we can find that there is no or less awareness among the stakeholders regarding the NTMs. Properly use of notified SPS and TBT measures to the WTO. So we can access the WTO database EP. We can WTO database through EP, but we cannot use properly. So we need to analyze the EP and then utilize in country's perspective. NTMs arising from domestic infrastructure should also be handled carefully. International regulatory cooperations can help, like if we implement a trade facilitation agreement, then some of the NTMs may be reduced. Alignment of national standards with its international standards is very helpful for removing NTMs. So that was my presentation. And I would like to thank you, professors and Daffodil University. And I would like to give you the floor to the other speakers. Thank you.
Raihan, are you there?
I cannot hear you.
I think that Raihan has lost his network. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mahmoud Ashkari, for your all the findings on the NTMs that we are facing. And thank you for your key forwards and probable solutions as well. Now it's time to hear from Dr. Rajneesh Clark, Associate Director, Planning and Monitoring and Head, Department of Economics, Adamas University, India. Thank you, sir. Please.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. First of all, I must congratulate the speakers on giving the broader perspective on the monetary measures globally as they are, you know, one of the peculiar issues globally, and given the specifics for the countries, India and Bangladesh. Let me share my screen. I hope my slides are visible.
Yes, it's now visible over here.
All right, perfect. So I think the broader perspective has been very beautifully explained by the two speakers. What I would focus would be a very specific focus on agriculture between India and Bangladesh. So we know that, you know, the recent visits of the two leaders, the recent meeting of the two leaders, I think the main impactful you know, the outcome of this meeting is regarding the predictability of trade policy, regulation and procedure. So we have gone a step ahead where we can have a better understanding that over the period of time, what we can predict from each other in terms of the trade policies, regulations and procedures. Of course, there were certain things which came from the Bangladesh side. There were certain things which came from the Indian side, and they were agreed upon. For example, we discussed about the lifting of the anti-dumping duty and the proposal of Bangladesh under public-private partnership for investment in jute mills. Now, coming to the agricultural trade, why I've focused my discussion on this non-tariff measures in agriculture trade, because of two reasons. One, we know that for both the economies, agriculture serves as one of the important sectors for employment. Okay? And number two, when we talk about agriculture trade, the agriculture goods are perishable. So the non-tariff barriers do impact the agriculture trade the most, the worst, because of the perishable nature of the agriculture product. And if you look at the bird's eye view, the employment in the agriculture sector, in India it's about 42.70, almost 43% of the total employment. Whereas in Bangladesh it's about 39% of the total of employment, which is a significant number. Whether we talk about the male employment or whether we talk about the female employment. So this sector and trade within this sector is very, very critical for both the countries. Looking at the trade stats and agricultural trade particularly, okay. Now we see that the percentage share has dipped over the period of time. And that's one of the important outcome of the non-tariff barriers existing from both the countries, from India and from Bangladesh. Both. If you look at India's agriculture trade with Bangladesh, the share has significantly gone down. Whereas the trade trends between India and Bangladesh, the overall trade trends, we are improving, we are going up, and it has been discussed in the previous discussion as well. Now, if you look at the trade routes, particularly for the agriculture trade, so existingly we have railway routes. So there are four main routes from where India and Bangladesh trade through railway. There are four main waterways, Kolkata, Haldia, Ramangal, and then there are these four major routes by which the waterways, by which the agriculture goods are exported and imported. But all these have major issues, major problems. Okay. And coming to the regulatory barriers, for example, Bangladesh also had export ban. There were import bans on the port restrictions. Okay. So the divergent taxing requirements are there. Language barriers are there. So they all act as the non-tariff barriers for the Indian exporters. Excessive testing requirements, for example. Now the problem, one of the major problems is that most of the ports from where the trade happens are non-EDI codes. And then this exchange data, electronic data exchange has to be strengthened for more smooth exports and imports or management of the ports when we talk about this trade between the countries. Now, if you look at these major ports, land ports, Agartala and Fulbari, Hilli, now, lots of barriers like non-facilities of testing of the labs, okay, absence of the AQ and CQ facilities near the borders, okay, and throughout the LCS, the average detention time of non-perishable goods is 10 to 12 days. There is lots of long processes, and then we talk about STS, which is majorly STS and CVC, imports, distorts the trade. So what we need to think is to develop these facilities over the port areas and near the port areas. For example, infrastructure. So the gaps in infrastructure availability is something which both the countries need to think of. Okay, because of lack of these infrastructure facilities, then there are route diversions. And particularly in the agriculture trade, because of these route diversions, a lot of the products get damaged. Right? And this entire, porous borders and things gives an opportunity to the syndicate to get benefit from. Okay. So this involvement of syndicates near the borders because of lack of these things, okay, it gives a lot of additional non-tariff barriers, okay, or additional non-tariff measures to the stakeholders. So the reduction in these is a powerful driver for fostering agricultural value chain. Now, if you look at the perspective to go and move ahead, If you look at the relationships of Bangladesh with India, we know that we are improving over the period of time. But I think this improvement has to accelerate now. The way it has been accelerating with China, Bangladesh, China, enjoy a lot of healthy relationships. You know, there are dedicated special economic zones from China in Bangladesh towards China, a dedicated EPZ. And the connectivity with China has increased over the period of time with China or Bangladesh quite rigorously. So, in all, what I would suggest is that Bangladesh is a country which is at the verge of expansion. And any country within that stage has to also look at the geopolitical situation. So, its relations with China are important. But at the same point of time, we understand that India and China also have certain conflict points. Now, there could be a lot of bilateral issues which need to be thought of by both the countries. But at the same point of time, I think these relations need to accelerate so that the country can have a balanced geopolitical situation with both the countries, India and China. So it's like, for a country, if we can quote theoretically the behavior like pilot fish behavior or the defensive realism. So one needs to choose the balance between both. Okay. So that's the point where the both countries can sit together and think about reducing these non-tariff measures over the period of time by creating a healthy infrastructure, by creating more political relationships there. The investment can flow between both the countries, and these lacunas which happens on which are existing in the port areas on the porous borders of India and Bangladesh. I think those are the areas which we need to focus on resolving, so that the trade can be healthier, and then the stakeholders also have their ease of trading among the borders. I think I would stop here. Thank you very much for the opportunity, and the overall structure which has been shared, so that's why I thought I should not go much on the overall perspective. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. And we have our audience online who are actually watching from Bangladesh as well as India. So I believe let me take two questions from the audience, at least to our tourist speakers of the webinar. So I'd like to request our IT team to share two questions. Okay, so we have one question, Shauna Jahan. What should be the real steps to remove these non-tariff barriers to in trade between the two countries? And I think Mr. Mamoon and Dr. R. Sugand can share their very short note on this question.
So, should I start up?
Please, sir.
Yes, please.
Oh, well, thank you for the question. It's a little bit tricky question to answer because a whole lot of issues are involved with this question. So first, I would like to, from my point of view, my experience point of view, say first, one country, both in India and Bangladesh, first point is we need to identify the problems. And then we should check, are these problems really creating a barrier for the exporters? Then we need to find the exact data and information, and those data and information should be placed in the proper forum, like bilateral trade negotiations, like joint working group in India, Bangladesh, like on the SAPTA forum. So then there are so many forums. If we could correctly identify and place in the proper place, then we have the possibility to get some positive feedbacks. Like we have previously received some kind of positive feedbacks from India, and India has got some positive feedback from Bangladesh. Thank you
so much. So Dr. R. Sugand, sir, please.
Yeah, I think one important thing is the vision of shared relationship driven by the heads of the state. In this case, yes, I think, I mean, now that there is a strong message which has gone that, yes, India and Bangladesh would like to share a very strong relationship, I'm sure that this will percolate down the level also. Then, I think, I mean, as what Mr. Mahmood very clearly indicated, you need to identify specifically the issues and then you can sit and discuss across the counter and then you can eliminate them. See, I mean, again, in this non-tariff measure, there can be, I mean, two type of measures, like one which may be an irritant. It may not really stop you from exporting to India, but the other may be an impediment. So, irritant is something, yes, I think, I mean, you need to look at the right policy, who has issued it, and how we can comply with that. So, that possibly, it may be much more easier to solve. But that impediment, which means that, I mean, it may not really permit you to export, and that is something which you need to identify and eliminate that totally. So, you need to very clearly, as what Mr. Mahmood was telling, identify these points and then take it up with the appropriate authority and then solve it.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, sir. So, can you have the next question, please, from the audience? Okay, so the next question from Jannat Nupur: what is the National Notification Authority of India for SPS? So, if Dr. Rajneesh sir could give a feedback on this question. Sir, your microphone, please. Can you hear us? I think we lost your audio. We cannot hear you. So in that case, if Dr. R. Sugan, sir, if you could share your feedback on this question. Your microphone, please.
Primarily, these are by Ministry of Health and Ministry of Agriculture. But having said that, we do not expect an exporter from Bangladesh to possibly look at every ministry, what they are issuing and things like that. So, ideally, they should be getting into this Indian Trade Portal. If you are looking at indiantradeportal.in. So, this is a comprehensive website which can help you navigate through the imports.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your feedback.
I just put that thing in the chat box.
Okay, we'll of course share with our audience in our social media. So let me move on to our next speaker. At this stage, let me welcome Mr. Nafiz Imtiaz Islam, Deputy Director of Enterprise Competitiveness Institute, ECI of DIU, to share his presentation on today's topic. Sir, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Sayyid Rehanul Islam. Am I audible?
Clearly. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So I'm sharing my screen over here. Is it visible?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay. Can you hear me?
You can hear me. Yeah.
Okay, it's not coming over here. I'm looking into it to fix the problem. So, Mr. Rehan, hello? Hello?
I think some network problem from his end, I think he dropped off.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay, so it's not... I'm unable to share my screen. So can I start over here from my slides? So can you hear me? I can talk over there. Is it okay?
Please go.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, before you start, am I audible now?
Yes, yeah. Dr. Rajneesh.
Yes.
Oh, thank God.
আমি স্ক্রিনটা শেয়ার করতেছি এখন, ঠিক আছে, দেখা যাচ্ছে? ওকে, সো ক্যান ইউ সি দ্য স্ক্রিন?
ইয়েস,
ওকে, সরি ফর দ্য ইনকনভিনিয়েন্স দ্যাট ফর দ্য ডিউ টু দ্য নেটওয়ার্ক প্রবলেমস আই হ্যাভ লস্ট দ্য কানেকশনস. So I will basically focus on a few issues on sanitary, phytosanitary measures, because some few of our students over there and they are watching, and I will clarify some points on SPS, and I will show the how SPS issues dealt effects on distorting the trade between Bangladesh and India. So first of all, the thing we have to see that we have a very fifth longest border area in the world, the India-Bangladesh border, and with India we have at 4096 kilometer.
So that means can you make your slide full screen?
Okay, sure, sir. Okay, so the thing is that
it has not come full screen.
Not come full screen. Okay,
what will you do? Press F5.
I have already given it over there.
Press F5.
No, I know that, but it's not working right now.
Doesn't matter, you can continue, I think.
Yeah, you can continue.
Okay, thank you. My question is that Bangladesh export to India is not in so much an ideal stage. In fact, we all assume and we all agree on that. Because despite reduced tariffs and duty-free, quota-free facilities to Bangladesh even. So I think that was the reason behind it. And in several studies, we have found that some non-tariff measures which turns into the non-tariff barriers, and these hinder our trade. And first of all, I like to issue the SPS issues, that one of the WTO agreement is agreement on application of sanitary phytosanitary measures. And in fact, for our students, I want to share that sanitary measures are related to life or health of human animals, while phytosanitary measures are related to the life or health of plants. And some standards setting bodies globally over there. One is Codex Alimentarius, another one is Food and Agricultural Organization International Plant Protection Convention. And another one is that Office International Des Epizootitis. SPS measures cannot be applied, in fact, discriminately. You cannot apply without any reason. There should be some reason, and there should be some, can only be applied to the extent necessary to protect the human, animal, and plant health life. And once again, I want to tell that it should be justified with a scientific principle based on the evidence and based on some international standards that we are applying in international trade. So another some forms you should know that it should be product should be come from the disease-free area, in fact. And inspection of products is another factor. And specific treatment of processing products is a vital issue over there. And setting or allowable maximum levels of pesticide residue or permitted use of only certain additives in food is the primary thing. And these are some things that for the purpose of the SPS agreement measures can be defined or can be applied, which you can find in WTO websites. I want to tell you some few examples of SPS measures that we are having with the India and Bangladesh trade. Something like that: harmonization of food standards, mutual recognition of conformity assessment. Third one is the dispute settlement. Technical cooperation is over there. And another issue is that specific packaging requirements. I can cite the example that all food samples need to be sent to Kolkata, which is around 400 and 500 kilometers away, as central food laboratory facilities are not available near all land ports. So some of the legal structure that in Bangladesh, in our major laws that regulate the SPS and technical barrier to trade issues in our country, which is briefly summarized over there. These all are the public entities, and these are the some acts and rules. And in private sector organization, the facilitators are FBCCI, which is Federation of Bangladesh Chamber of Commerce and Industries. Various chambers of commerce, Bangladesh Frozen Food Exports Association, Bangladesh Agro Processing Association, and Bangladesh Fruits, Vegetables, and Allied Products Exporters Associations. I just want to shed the light towards how SPS works and what are the SPS status in both the countries. So, in a study of Asian Development Bank, where we have found that 127 Bangladeshi products have potential for exports in India, but have either zero or limited exports in reality, as all of those products face either SPS or TBT measures in that market. I think that we should focus on this issue also. And Mr. Mahmoud Mamoun Ashkari has also uttered and shared his views on this issue in his slides. Recently we have found that Government of India conveyed that under the provision of the new custom rules, as like in this sentence, that in the event of a conflict between a provision of these rules and rules of origin of a trade agreement, the provisions of the rules of origin of the trade agreement shall prevail. So we Bangladesh has raised some objections to India's Indian government's to request for this verification of country of origin certificates. And attachment of questionnaire to those things, this will be in the violation of the SAFTA rules, in fact. And reportedly, new customs rules of India 2020 have made it tough for countries having preferential deals to get, in fact, tariff preferences in India. So I think that we have to look into the issue. And in this platform, from the private sector, we are raising the issue. Anyway, another one is that we have also some unnecessary NTB hampers the trade. That during 2011, jute bags from Bangladesh has been labeled, which is made in Bangladesh in order to enter the India market, which is clearly an absolutely unnecessary NTB. And imposed anti-dumping DP is another issue for jute yarns. And this anti-dumping duty, in fact, acts as a non-tariff measures on Bangladeshi exporters of goods. So I think that Dr. Clara has also issued some points over port issues. Here is some increase, but I think that to make a very good port management, we need to increase the cooperation among border agencies. So it's one of the very vital issues, I think so, from my perspective. Our preparedness from Bangladesh part, we want to increase the compliance capacity of Bangladesh exporters in selected sectors and effectively addressing the legitimate NTBs. We enhance the ability of government agencies to reduce trade distorting NTBs through negotiation with fund counterparts. We are in a state to enable the in-country border trade agencies to take adequate measures to address at the border and behind the border procedural obstacles. And another one is then addressing this issue. I am also come to the end of my views that we have already taken some issues like national single window has been introduced in Bangladesh, And we have also implemented the customs modernization strategy action plan. And so these are all of the issues regarding sanitary and phytosanitary measures. And I've tried to focus some issues on TBT, on some non-tariff measures. So due to the time constraint, I think that these are the things that may be thought-provoking for us. So thank you very much, Dr. Arsugan, Dr. Mamoonur Rashid Ashkari, and Dr. Rajneesh Clark, to having a very good time over there. And it was really an outstanding and experience for us even. So we may go forward in later on. Thank you very much. Thank you. Over to Raihan. I think that Ryan has lost his connection. So can Mr. Arif provide some queries if at our Facebook social media regarding our webinar?
Yeah, if permitted, can I add to the answer to the question which was asked for the FTS, the Indian Agency? One can also go to the Directorate General of Foreign Trade, DGFT, Ministry of. Okay, so that also gives information from the FTS, which is used by the exporter.
Okay, fine. But I think that who have raised the question have satisfied with the answer. So, Mr. Arif, can you once again please view the questions? So what are the differences between NTM and NTB, non-tariff measures and non-tariff barriers? Mr. Opu Ahmed has asked a question. So I think that Dr. Clark, would you please mind to answer the question to Mr. Opu Ahmed? Thank you.
Right. See, the non-tariff barriers, non-tariff measures are broad. Okay, they include the qualitative and the quantitative measures as well. Whereas non-tariff barriers are the subset of the non-tariff measures. Okay, which have influence or a potential ability to affect the trade. Okay, trade in everything. Okay. So non-tariff measures (NTM) are very broad and include quantitative restrictions as well. Okay. Along with the qualitative restrictions. Whereas non-tariff barriers are subset of the non-tariff measures. So that's the broader difference between the two.
I think that Mr. Opomad has got his answers. You have rightly mentioned regarding the differences between non-tariff measures and non-tariff barriers. So we have had, I think that Arif, is there any queries or questions? What is Codex Alimentarius? Can Mr. Nafis please explain? Well, thank you, Mr. Mursalin Abir. Thank you for your queries. The Codex Alimentarius means the food code. It's a collection of a few international standards, measures, standards, guidelines, and food codes of practice. To protect the health of consumers of the country, and it basically ensure fair practices in the food trade. This guideline or this book is published by the Food and Agricultural Organization, FAO. I think that you have had your answers. Is there any query, any questions? Mr. Arif? Okay, I think that we have not other questions to there. So I think that thank you all the guests and participants to joining at this August event. So I think that if I can summarize the issues that we have already discussed over here, it would be much more a takeaway. That Mr. Mohammad Mamoon Ashkari have rightly pointed out the import and export, uh, uh, sorry, uh, Dr. R. Sugand has rightly figured out the trade between Bangladesh and India, that import is 6 point something billion and export is 800 billion million. He has pointed out over infrastructural issues, which can manage the NTB and NTM issues. And he has cited over the examples of power sector cooperation, and also some points over regulatory changes and IP issues. He has told about the Indian safety standards, and we came to know from his presentation that there are 38 agencies is working in India regarding the SPS and TBT notification, and four ministries in the key point. So if I can analyze the presentation of Mr. Mamoon Rashid Ashkari, he has told over there that NTM coverage is in WTO. He has addressed the certification issues and made some very realistic and updated data of 2021 that SPS enforced in 46 measures in our trade issues, and also other NTM issues over there, something like anti-dumping duty, technology standards and technological regulation. He also explained Azure free test for garments manufacturer, and unaligned food safety also. So thank you. And if we can analyze Mr. Clark, then he have focused the issue of three points: the agricultural trade, some jute mills, and procedural barriers. He has also discussed the importance of regional and geopolitical issues. And I think that India is our neighboring and friendly country, so we have to have respect each other. And we think that we can move forward with our approaches. So I think, and Bangladesh region, I want to make one point for Mr. Clark, that we have taken the project on Bangladesh regional connectivity project regarding the port management issue. So these are the thing. I think that for such type of webinar or such type of seminar is very much fruitful and very much effective for us, for our bonding, for the relationship that we have been maintaining over the years. And it's
thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nafis. Over to Mr. Rayhan.
Thank you so much, all the speakers. Our heartfelt gratitude goes all of you for joining us from both Bangladesh and India to discuss the findings, sharing your analysis and views with our audience today. So also thanks to our audience for watching us and listening to all the speakers from home and abroad, of course, from our neighboring country, India. We hope that the regional experts, policymakers, government officials will find better solution to overcome NTBs in trade between these two countries. And on behalf of ECI and International Affairs, I'd like to thank all of you once again for joining us today. Please stay safe, keep your surrounding and loved ones safe as well. And have a great day. Thank you and bye-bye. Thank you so much, all of you.
Thank you very much.